Okay, yeah. Hi, this is Srini here. Today I'm going to talk about the Application Security Champion. And first, I would like to know if how many of the developers are here so that I'll get an understanding of how deep I have to go about the development here. So it's just to understand about how many of the developers here. Wow. Okay. It's like half of them. Okay. First, to start off with, why do we need an AAC in a team, or how he is going to help the implement of the security for the development team? This is what we are going to talk about. I'm an application developer and a security interested guy. So, okay. Before going on, nowadays a lot of companies are going to implement security, but first of all, why do we need to implement the security is the one biggest question, and the companies are investing a lot of money in implementing the security. So before going into the security, I would like to say that all the companies are investing in security because of the data loss. Of if you see the records in the past history, the data loss happens across the world for all the companies. So if you go into the details of how much of the data loss happens year by year, you can see 2014, 2015, and the latest of 2016. So this many millions of records has been lost from the companies. So that happens in two ways. Either the hackers can be hacked, or it can be happening from the inside jobs. Inside in the sense, the people who work for the companies has all these things. If you see that, so 2015 September, InfoSecurity Magazine has released a statement saying that 43% of the data loss occurs due to the inside employees. So it might be either the known or unknown. So they might be knowing of how the data is getting lost, or without knowing them, like misconfigurations kind of a thing. So that is how the data is getting lost, and the hackers can easily get into the servers and steal the data. So that can happen either by not implementing the security within the internal application. So let's say a security or the hacker gets into one of the server by somehow, and then he can use the internal tools or internal applications to get into the another servers kind of a thing. So that is how we have to, or the developers has to think of how the internal applications has to be developed securely so that they defend themselves. So for that, let's say we have to build a security into a development life cycle. So what is that going to do, or how that going to help the development team or the company of implementing the security? Okay, if we talk about the security in right now, how the teams are implementing, I'm going into the detail. So this was the SDLC saying that, okay, analysis, design, development, and testing. So all these phases are part of SDLC. If you look at this button here, so as part of testing, security testing is minimal. You can see how much minimum it is in the part of SDLC. So what that going to cost is, when the developers want to do the security testing, they might be implementing at the end of their SDLC phase. So that what that means is, okay, they are not ready to spend some time on security testing. They might be hurrying in releases. So that takes into this remediation cost when they found the security issues in the last minute. So how much time it takes, or how much cost it takes to implement or remediate those security issues. So how to solve this? So how can we make sure the security has been implemented across the SDLC and getting this cost flip-flop? Right now, if you see, we are not going to concentrate on security in analysis or design or in a development phase. So while testing, there'll be a security team, like a professional teams who does any penetration testing or static code analysis or a dynamic testing here. So for them, if a development team engaged those security professionals in the last minute, they might have 1 week or 2 weeks of a time to test on the web application, and they might have found few issues, and then they say, okay, these are the issues which has to be remediated. But in the last minute, developers might not have a time to implement or to fix those issues, and they'll be releasing that into the production. So let's say, okay, major issues might have been fixed, but not all of them can be fixed in the last minute. And it's equally proportional, saying that, okay, in the last minute, if you find anything, so it takes a lot of time again and again to fix those security issues, it has to go from all the phases. Again, the development, testing, and again, the releasing. So that is why the cost of remediating any security issues in the last minute takes a lot of time. So to get that resolved, if we concentrate on how we can implement the security to avoid those things, it has to be horizontally implemented, not the vertical or at end of the stage. So security has to be implemented in analysis, design, development, and testing, and the release phase. So that is how we start thinking of security from the initial stage to the end of thing. So it has to be implemented in across the SDLC, so that whenever you develop any application, it goes on from design and the development and the testing and the maintenance mode. So if you see this security which has been implemented across SDLC, it takes a lot of time and thinking to implement all these things. And then to implement this, we might need more security professionals as well, so that there are not a lot of security issues after releasing your application, and which helps that to flip-flop this from cone to a pyramid. So a lot of security issues or anything has been identified in the initial stages and then fixed then and there before it goes to the next phase of your SDLC. So if you see here, this is analysis and design, development, testing, and at the end it is the production or release and maintenance thing. So here it doesn't mean we don't find any issues at the last minute of your SDLC or in production. Of course, there will be a lot of issues, but lot of issues will be finding out here, and the minimum of issues will be at the production ones. So to implement this, okay, let's say we have 10 development teams. We might have one or two security professionals in the organization. Let's say we have 100 development teams. We might not find all the security professionals to be included in each team to implement from here to here. So that takes a lot of cost to the company to hire a lot of security professionals and then engage them into the team. And that professional has to have a product or a domain knowledge of that team which the product is being developed for. So to solve that, some few guys have thought that, okay, we have a development teams, multiple teams. To implement that SDLC, we might not have a security professional for each and every team. So how to resolve that is identifying a developer or a manager who knows about the domain and the product and little bit of a development knowledge. So they will be nominated as a security champions. What they does is they take care of security issues from all the phases. So they will be trained, and so this security champions will be trained by these security teams. So already an organization might have a professional security teams who knows from end to end. So, and the developers who doesn't know, who have a minimum knowledge of a security. So this security team will be trained for one of them. Why not all of them? It takes a lot of time, and not all of them might be interested in the security. So each one of the member will be trained, nominated as a security champion, and he or she will be trained in the security things. So what's the usage of that? So that AAC will be the first line of defense for your products or for your team. So he will be remediating all the security issues within the products, and he will be engaging security and architectures and all the development teams and the post releases things. So he will be engaging from end to end in the SDLC. So he will be doing some few code reviews in the development. So when there is a code review, he will be identifying, okay, there is a SQL injection or cross-site scripting. So those things will be identified as part of code review. So and he will be engaging this product to be going through all the scannings, and then issues will be identified and remediated. Okay, we have an AAC now, and then how can he implement all of them within the products? So when and what has to be implemented? So like I said before, security has to be implemented horizontally, not in a few part of a SDLC. It has to be horizontal. So analysis and design, what has to be done, and development and testing and post production releases. So there are few tools which help AACs or security teams to identify, okay, to identify if there are any issues in your code or bugs, anything. So let's talk about analysis and design. If we say, okay, before I develop any product, how can I know if there are any security issues or not? So how will a development team or someone who is building a product knows what has to be implemented as part of security? Now, before developing, architecture guys might be known of their product, what has to be implemented, at least in the product or the domain knowledge, not about the security, but at least. So these are a few tools which help in implementing it. So SD Elements is one of the tool which gives you the security requirements. These SD Elements take, you have to fill up a 30 minutes questionnaire. It asks for questions like, okay, which platform are you using to build your product, like Java, .NET, or any other language? And it says, is your application a web application or Windows application? Do you have a web services or a Windows services? Or do you have a web APIs implementing in your product? So once you fill up all those questions, it gives you a report or an analysis saying that, okay, these are the things which you have to be taken care of. Let's say authentication. Have you implemented any authentication in your project? Or authorizations kind of a thing. So all these things will be part of SD Elements reports or analysis. So once you see this, okay, then the architectures and the AACs might be knowing of, okay, before starting my product, they will be knowing of what has to be implemented as part of security. So that is how these tools helps. There are a lot of tools, but here I have used minimum of only few of them, which I can explain. So that is how analysis and design, security will be taken care of that phase. If we move on to the development and testing phases, okay, now we have a security requirements. Once we have a security requirements, developers will be developing their product. So like I said, okay, once a product has been moved to production or a testing phase, it's very hard to get it back to fix all the issues. So this is there are a few plugins which helps as part of your development. So as soon as you write a code and save it, it says, okay, within your code you have few issues. Okay, how to fix your issues, and what are the why that line of a code is an issue. So Sigital, there is a Secure Assist plugin which that plugin supports Visual Studio and Eclipse as well. So once you save, it says if there are any issues in your code. And there is a SonarQube. So this is an open source project which helps to identify all the rules has been met within your development. Sorry, within your code. Once your code commits to any SVN, so there are a lot of there are plugins which can be included integrated with Jenkins for SonarQube. And once you commit the code to SVN, it has rules defined in the servers or wherever the configuration location. So it takes care of that rule sets and it applies to your code. And it says, okay, this line of a code violates this rule. And then that will be after the development once you commit the code. So as soon as you commit the code, you know what are the issues with your code. And this takes care of the standards. and you can implement after that. So before it goes to testing, this tools helps you identify few issues and then it can be fixed it. And there are a few other tools like HP Fortify, VeraCode or IBM AppScan. So these are the static and dynamic analysis tools which will be going through your code. Let's say if we talk about the static analysis, it's like identifying the issues. So HP Fortify or VeraCode, which helps, it goes through all your code without executing of any of your code. So without executing, it identifies all of your issues. And let's say there is some SQL injection in your code or your XML files which has to be configured, or web.config kind of a thing. So all your configurations, if it has any connection strings, and your connection strings might have a passwords which has not been encrypted. So that issues also will be identified as part of the static scanning. And it gives you the reports such that those reports can be sent to your management and say, okay, these many issues are there, and then these issues needs this much time to implement them. And then you can prioritize, and actually that tool helps you prioritize whether the issues are high, critical, or a medium, or a low. So once the tool helps you to identify whether it is a critical or medium, it helps the management to take a decision on, okay, at least I need this critical issues has to be resolved as part of first release, and later we'll take care of medium and low. And it also gives these tools also helps you give a remediation code samples as well. Okay, this is an issue, why it has been an issue, and where that issue has come from. Let's say we have an input fields which doesn't have a validation. Let's say it accepts a string, and you can enter any star percentage so that which goes to at the end of SQL, and then it fetches all the records which the application don't impact for. So those kind of issues will be identified as part of this static and dynamic scanning. And this dynamic scanning, when we say these tools will deliberately put lot of malicious data into the input fields. Let's say your web application has been moved to UAT. Once the application has been moved to UAT, these dynamic testing tools, dynamic scanning tools, will validate from each and every fields, and then it gives again the same results for you. So all these things will be applied as part of testing. And here, if we talk about this tool helps as part of your development, and the SonarQube after you commit the code to your SVM. And these static and dynamic tools will be helping you after your code commits to SVN, and then the static scanning happens. Let's say for all these things, you are the one who is developing the code and the development team. Let's say you don't have a development code, or you might be using third-party libraries. So you might not be having a code for them. So how do you scan, or how do you implement your security for those part of things? You might be thinking, okay, I'm using only one library of third party, but that library might be using another library which automatically downloads into your code. So that developers might not be known of that. So how do you scan with those open source libraries which you don't have a code of? So few tools like Black Duck scanning. Black Duck, this tool helps with all those third party libraries as well. So this maps issues from third party or any DLLs or anything, any products from its own vulnerability issue. So it maps all of them, and it gives you the report saying that, okay, these open source tools or the products have these many issues. So once the code has been scanned by Black Duck, it gives all your reports. So with that, you can see, okay, this many softwares which I am using have this many issues. So at that time, you might be taking a decision saying that, okay, whether I have to use this open source or not. So these tools helps to take that decisions, and then it gives. So there are a few other tools like Metasploit. So these are used for penetration testing. So we have seen here, okay, the security requirements which we consider here, and as part of development, we'll be using them. And here, static and dynamic scanning, and here, a third-party libraries or open source code. So once the application moves out of testing, it goes to production or pre-production to production. So these tools will be used by actually penetration testing team or security professionals. So all these tools might not be used by the security champion. So he might be the only one in your team, one or two guys. So there'll be a professional team, like I said, who has already trained this security champion within the team. So they will be doing the penetration testing, and then they will be sending a reports for the team. And okay, once we have implemented all this from design or analysis to the release, so are we done yet? No, actually it's not. So this process has to be repeated every time. Every time you start, let's say if now Agile, a sprint starts from 2 weeks, so from the first to end, you have to again repeat all the process, all of them. You have to scan all your code, and then you have to, whatever the issues has been identified, it has to be fixed as part of the next sprint. So that is how you resolve. So before it goes to the production, there will be multiple sprints or multiple cycles which your code goes through. So that is how we can implement the security horizontally. Okay, coming to that, a security champion will be the one person in the team. So can he help implement all of them? All the security issues can be fixed? No, he might not be. So that is how he has to build a culture, like saying that, okay, when in my absence or I might not be the one who is fixing all the issues, so I need help from the team. So he should be training all the members in the development team what he has gained the knowledge of, so that all the developers are aware of the security issues, and then they know how to remediate those security issues, so that it goes on and goes on. So that is how the slides. And so I'm going through the summary of what the problem is here, the data loss across the applications and the organizations, and how to implement that. So a security team and the development team comes to an agreement, and then nominates a security champion, and then he will be trained and he helps other members in the team to implement all those security issues and then bring awareness within the team. And that ends the presentation here.
Are there any questions?
Are the tools programming language dependent on, is it agnostic to the different programming language?
Yeah, those tools helps. Those tools are designed for multiple languages like .NET, Java, or PHP, or ASP, classic ASP kind of. Each tool might not be supporting all the languages, but major languages they will support the major languages. Okay, right now we have AngularJS, so they might not be supporting a new technology like AngularJS, though it has been in the market from last 2 years, but few of them like JavaScript, .NET, Java, they support them. And you have plugins which can be integrated to Jenkins, so that you have a rule set, you can apply it with whatever the language you have.
Anybody else?
Sunny, just one thing, apart from these tools and all, what about trainings? Like if you want to change a culture in your development team, and if you want to train your developer in the secure coding and all, so how you implement the training culture in your team from your experience?
Okay, let's say once AAC has been nominated within a team, so he will be a developer who has a domain knowledge. So let's say if a security professional has been assigned for this team without any AAC process, he might not be knowing of this product. So let's say he identifies a major issue that might be part of this domain. So these developers say, oh, this is not an issue. So that is how AAC will be trained by this security team, saying that, okay, these are the things which you have to take care. And he will go through the training, let's say 30 hours of the training. So that might give him a basic knowledge of security. And he already has he is already working on the product. So he knows the domain knowledge. So he is the one who judges, okay, whether this is a security issue or it can go with this issue, or this is a minimum one which has to be fixed later, kind of a thing. So he takes care of those decisions, and he helps the team to take a decisions in the security perspective. And okay, once he has to pass on to the knowledge, it's up to him. So he has to build that culture. It's not a mandatory or anything. He might be keeping his knowledge, but like Stephen, he has presented a very first presentation, and he said these things has to be considered as a culture, not as a responsibility or a role. It shouldn't be taken as a role. It has to be a culture. So that depends on person to person. So he has to pass on the knowledge so that he gains more, and then it passes on to the team. It might not be like, he might not be giving another training to the team. He might be saying, okay, when the code review happens, he can explain, okay, this is how the issue happens. I'll give an example. Last week I was reviewing a code where, okay, it was supposed to give a name or the list of users with his last name, search of a last name. So it has been, how it has been implemented is, okay, you give a last name, it fetches and whatever the matches, it brings all the users from the list. So I gave a SQL injection, like, okay, quotes 1=1. It bought all of them. So that is how we explain, okay, how this is an issue, a security issue, and how this can be fixed. So that team knows, okay, this is an issue. So that is one part. And other part, you can train, okay, minimum things. Let's say, okay, how SD elements can be used as part of one training. And another time, you might have a time, so you give a training of other tools which has been implemented as part of it. So that is how you train one by one.
One other thing in terms of when security team finds gives a report to the management, specifically product owners, right?
Yeah.
Mostly they just don't give a priority to the security issues.
Yes.
Because it's coming from security team, you have to explain the why it has to be prioritized. But as from your experience as an application security champion, when you talk about those issues with your management, with your product owner or scrum master, how they take in terms of response, how is their response when you present the same issues? You know, I am from a security background, I know how it has with our experience, like when we go to the management or product owners or scrum master, they say, oh, we have a release thing and all that. But since you have a domain knowledge of your product and then you have a security knowledge, when you go with those product, how is your response in terms of experience, in terms of response from a product owner or scrum master?
Okay, let's say a security issue has come from a professional security team. They might have already put in a list saying that, okay, these are the high issues, these are the medium issues. And AAC might have already have his own set of issues with his static analysis or dynamic analysis. He might have his own. But when it goes to the security professionals, they will give. So this security champion will all gather all the security issues and then creates, okay, these are the high issues. In that high, these three are mandatory. It has to be implemented within next release. It shouldn't go without these things fixed. So then he has to explain to the project product owner saying that your product will not go without these issues fixed. So he has to come, they has to come to an agreement. There should be a negotiation saying that, okay, these issues can be stay later. This can implement later. But these things, it has to go. So that is how you negotiate with the product owner. You can't implement all of them together. He might not be interested in implementing all of them together. That's his job or that his role. So he will not approve all of them, but you have to negotiate how many you can implement within that sprint or things.
Yes,
sir. Yeah.
What's the ratio of security team to the strength of that?
It depends on company to company or organization to organization. You can have like a 10 people, you might have one security champion. And it also depends on how many applications your team handles. Let's say a team of 5 people are developing like 5 products. So that might lead to one person handling all the 5 products along with his development. It takes a lot of his time. So there you might nominate two people saying that, okay, for analysis and design, let's say a security requirements, I'll nominate another person, and another phase, I'll nominate another person. So these two guys will take care of each phases and multiple applications as well. If we don't nominate a ASC, now you have to hire a lot of security professionals and engage them with individual teams. So at that time, it takes a lot of security resources, like let's say 20%, like you said. But you already have a development team, you will be nominating one of them. So you already have a resource, but he will be trained in the security. So you are not actually bringing in new guys. You already have a resource.
Question.
Yeah.
We understood the champion bit of it well. What I'm trying to understand is the champion wait and just let go and he has to go ahead and do his job away continuously, and security term, these are two islands, they work separately with each other?
No, not actually. He engages with all the architectures, security teams, and the developers.
Yeah, but the context behind what I ask is security is constantly evolving also.
Yeah.
So, and if you have ASC, how does the ASC himself get trained? That is one point of where we're looking at.
Okay.
And then, how is these two linked to each other? Because there needs to be a point where the ASC also has to continuously work with the security team, otherwise he's going to be with stale information and thought process.
Yeah. Okay, I'll just explain. Okay, first thing, how ASC is getting trained. You already, organizations already have a professional security team, which they will be training these nominated guys. Let's say, like I explained, 30 hours of the training or 40 hours, how much time it takes. So they have to train them. It's a mandatory, or you have to get external resources to get it trained. Or unless until you train, they are not going to know about the security. So once you train, he might not be getting end to end of the security. So you have to be, again, there the negotiation happens. Okay, how much of the load can AAC take? So like static scanning, till the dynamic scanning, he might be taken care of. But apart from that, there are penetration testing. He might not be knowing of the knowledge of the penetration testing. So AC will take care of till static scanning. And the professional security team might have, okay, dynamic scanning and penetration testing. So till this phase, AC will be having the continuous integration setup. So security professionals will provide a rule set saying that, okay, these are the rule sets which has to be followed. So they will apply that rule set with the code which has been developed, and then the reports are generated. So the AAC helps the development team implement the rule sets which has been given by the security professionals. And after the static scanning, the product goes to the security professionals actually. And then they take care of dynamic testing and the penetration testing, let's say. So the security guy has to engage the professionals to go through the process, right? Then only it can go to the post-production or the production.
So it's essentially shifting the activities from the very right to the very left.
You don't need multiple security professionals.
Yeah. You essentially give them the same tools to be used later on, right?
Yeah.
To get the feedback from the vulnerabilities back to the development team early on. So they can fix it while they're still working with the code, as opposed to having shipped the release or get it to the testers and are done out of the zone, then they get all the results and implement them again. So it's just much more efficient that they can actually scale this and do it with the same tools that the security people are using later on as well.
Hi, my name is Dan. Just came from Israel. I just worked for the Tel Avivian municipality for quite a time. So we've been working all with all the schools and with all the security CDS process. And we have big issues with security champions. Security champions, these tools give you like vulnerabilities, but not best practices. Best practices are always low, like all the time changing. Once you give some power to the security champion, he will guide you to probably not the best practice solution. So you're getting a very good thing with all champions, like in every team, then everything is good. But then the champion thinks that he has the answers. Once he has the answers, he gives the answers to the development team, but then the development team thinks that the security, okay, I didn't get this order, what's happening here? So it's getting to the release with the security issues, and there's a big mix up in this type of giving some kind of people that are not security, but hardcore, but very professionals, giving some power and understanding security. So as we saw, we took this power from these people. No more security champions in anywhere. I'm the security champion. The second one, the quantifying the vulnerabilities and giving time. These tools give you check marks and every other tools give you hundreds and hundreds of vulnerabilities. You cannot quantify time. There's no way of quantifying time and giving it to the manager saying, okay, this will give you like 30 hours of work. This is not possible. This is not possible. Giving, as you said, in Agile, probably you will take a few SQL injections.
Okay.
It depends what type of layers you have for SQL injection. So it's also getting, and the third thing that I wanted to share, because I have this very big issue in this type of process, is having the best practices against the vulnerabilities. So sometimes you're getting through, okay, you see all this development done, this postback everywhere. So you're saying, okay, this is best, it's not the best practice, and it's probably you will see some security issues in this type of practice in like, in not maybe now, but the next few months. So it's sometimes that you don't really know how to approach this. Are you approaching the best practices as the coding? Or you looking actually for the vulnerability? So you have to look for vulnerability and show the developers there is a vulnerability, now fix it. But then you're getting frustrated as you like working seriously. This is very bad practice. How do you deal with this type of features?
Yeah.
People are working with bad practice, but with might be having vulnerabilities issues, but you don't really have the time looking for them.
Yeah, okay.
So they give you like 10 hours, but you know the hacker has 30, 50 hours, and you know for sure if you will like explore it, you probably say. And this is like the big thing about bounty hours and hours, like, but it is different.
Okay, coming to your first point, right? You said AACs has been handed over. The security has been handed over to the AACs. So that is a wrong prescription. Okay, how it should have been there is, AACs are not the ones who take care of every security issues. So he is not taking a decision to release a product into the production. That will be part of a professional security team. He helps the team to identify the issues and fix as early as possible. But at the end, if the product has to go to production, it has to go to the professional security team, it has to go through their gateway. Then they know, okay, this application has been implemented to CI, or this has this many issues, this has been fixed, this will be fixed as part of another sprint, but all the mandatory ones are being fixed. So that decision taking has to be the security professionals, not the AAC. He helps the team, not releases. Yeah. If he is the one who takes care of everything, then that's the wrong way of implementing the AAC. That shouldn't have been.
This is not technically actually. PHP at one point of time used to have something called a magic quotes, which was a security feature. But the abuse of it was so bad that PHP decided to take it out. That's the problem. I actually agree with this. What would happen is that the thought process thinks that, hey, you did it, so it should be fine. And that's where the problem is. Where you might actually put in a system which is very good from a thought process. But when the abuse happens, how do you handle it? And that's where we really want to think about. I'm not saying the system is wrong. I'm only thinking about how do you handle the abuse, where people make use of the system and their faulty systems.
If an issue has been identified by any of the tools, saying that, okay, this, like you said, that issue has been alerted, and this security champion or whoever, this guy says, okay, without fixing this issue, it has to go to the product. It can go to the production. Then he should be giving a reason to you, a security professional, saying that, okay, why he can go without fixing that issue. And then once you say, okay, I accept with the reason he gave me, then only you will be allowing it. Like I said before, for he should not be taking a decision of releasing it to production.
This is on the situation where identified situations there. Situations where if there are false negatives, where an identification has not even happened, and we are assuming it's clean.
It is an assumption then.
We are assuming it's clean and passing it to production. Yeah. That's where the problems can start creeping in. And we've taken a problem to production.
But adding to your second point, how to quantify the effort?
Yeah,
it's a big problem. So initially, how it works, you have to reach a point where you decide on implement the system. Let's say you find a security issue, you pass it to Jira, right? A log issue in Jira. So Jira has a very good thing, or any bug tracking system. The issue when it's logged and when issue it's closed, or when it's verified it's closed, right? So there you can calculate a mean time to remediate, right? So initially for the first year, or probably for the next, when you start a security program, for first or second year, you won't have the mean time to remediation. But after 2 years, when you have like at least the one category of issues like SQL injection or cross-site scripting or any other issues which has been fixed by the development team in last 2 years, then you have a data to calculate or decide what is the mean time to remediate for a particular category of issue. And that's where, once you have the data, then you can implement the mean time to remediate. And then in the project management, especially I'm talking about in the terms of project management, then you can give a data to the project management team. Hey guys, you have 10 number of accesses issues. And as per our past record, it takes this much of time to remediate this. So make a plan to remediate these issues. This much of effort of time you will take in this sprint. So that's how you calculate.
This is huge in organizations. Once you have small organizations,
yeah.
it's very hard to get this information.
Exactly.
And people don't gather this information too much. And the last question.
Adding to this point, it doesn't make him to be only security, right? A product owner has, his job would be implementing all the stories within the small time or within that sprint. At that time, like a scrum master or a developer say, okay, these we can't implement all of them. We can only implement these things. You have a lot of issues, you have to negotiate with your product owner. These are the mandatory ones which has to work right now. So that is how you negotiate with your product owner.
And this you have too many organizations. How to implement a solution for this and this, for XSS,
yeah.
For XSS.
Yeah, once you give a reason to the management saying that, okay, security, at the end, security team, which actual security team, doesn't allow your product to go to production without fixing this, then he doesn't have any option.
What the problem?
I want to interrupt. You know what? I do a lot of this sort of work. I think we should have a session where you actually describe this so we'll all understand how to do it better. In fact, I'm serious. At an upcoming event, Stefan's got a workshop on this very topic, on how to make sure it is rolled out the right way. I think we should actually discuss this.
Can you please just thank you? Can you please the last question I had about the best practices, again, both the abilities with the development team? How do you approach this developers? If it's backpackers or mobility?
No, one thing I would like to say is we shouldn't be forcing anyone to implement anything. Once you force, they'll be going into a defensive mode saying that, no, I'm not going to implement this. You have to be proactive saying that, okay, you can implement this way or this way. If you implement this way, our product doesn't go through the security group. If you have to implement this way, if you find a time, you can implement this way.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So it's very frustrating looking at this code and like
this. Yeah, it depends on person to person how he takes when you say saying that okay, this has to be implemented. He might take it as a positive or he might take it as a negative.
Yes, thank you.
Yeah, I guess we can have a more discussion on this topic.
Yeah. It's very important, I think.
Yes. Just to ask this
managing perspective.
Yeah, managing from the project manager perspective.
I'm also curious to see who of you has heard about the term security champion before this talk today. Okay, quite a few. So I think that actually the benefit is one, scalability, and two, culture. Because you all know if somebody comes from a security team that maybe doesn't know your application, but it tells you what to do, there will always be like immediately a different kind of communication. But if you have somebody in that team that cares about security, and not everybody does, you will be able to have like a very different conversation about the same topics. That is more like together in the DevOps way, if you will, as opposed to you have to do this now, etc. So I think there's definitely a value in having security champions, especially there are not enough security gurus out there to scale throughout the world. It's just not going to happen. We have to start somewhere, and I think by getting security champions into the mix and start at least somewhere, it's really going to make a difference in the long term.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks, Sri.